On today's adventure, we're going to be exploring one of Arizona's best preserved Old West ghost towns, Vulture City. If you've watched our channel for any length of time now, you know that we've referred to Vulture City probably on many episodes, and we've been out here, I think in 2019 was our last visit, and we've been coming out here for over a decade now. So I wanted to share with you guys the then and now aspect of Vulture City. We knew it when it was pretty much just crumbling debris, and what they've turned it into today, it's pretty impressive. This is an old garage, a gasoline station perhaps, from way back in the day. And you know, I just noticed there's even old, looks like old newspapers in here too. Really neat stuff when you just keep your eye open for what they have. This place has been really well known for many years of being a photographer's paradise, just because there's so much old stuff strewn about. Really interesting lighting conditions coming in through these corrugated roofs. Things pretty much crumbling, or I don't know what we're going to call this. This is a little bit restored, but still really old, and you know it is. And a lot of this stuff was here way back over a decade ago now, in 2010, when Amy and I visited this place in a much different state than what you see today. And yeah, today they've created, you know, lots of beautiful displays here, little miniature museums. There's an old Hercules dynamite explosive box that you'll find in a lot of mines. But here's a rendition of how they would drill back in the day, using maybe some kind of pneumatic system. I don't know, air or water, steam, who knows? It's riveted, old 1800s looking. And yeah, they would just drill, use these big drills to like drill holes in the rock, then they'd shove dynamite in there and then explode it. I was wondering where this was. I'd see online there's like an official historic plaque somewhere here, and here it is. And it's just recounting Mr. Henry Wickenburg, the discoverer of this mine, discovered it in 1863. But yeah, we'll talk more about all the stuff we're gonna see today. And yeah, there's this interesting house too. I don't know if it's open now. Sometimes that's where you'll go in for certain events. And I think when back we came here in 2010, I think this is where they had a caretaker and we paid admission. Not sure if we can go in here now or not. Is it locked? It's open. Make a couple adjustments. This room is neat. This is what I remember from 2019. The Vulture's Roost. Yeah, more exhibits. I mean, this place has really done a fantastic job of gathering up period relics. I'm sure many of which were recovered from this general vicinity. Some were probably donated or found in antique shops, perhaps, who knows. But yeah, there's a lot to do and see. And of course, no good ghost town would be without ghosts. And this place certainly has its own legends and thoughts around that. And I think this is where they host actually certain paranormal events, where they have paranormal enthusiasts will do tours and stuff at night, like little ghost tours and stuff. So yeah, that's one other aspect I do like about this place, especially when it's a quiet day and there just aren't people around. Is just wandering through the old buildings, thinking about what events, you know, what were people's lives like in that time, all of that stuff. But yeah, the fun part of me that enjoys a little bit of haunted history, yeah, this place is very well known for a lot of that. In case you don't have your own photographic evidence as we do, you can actually see the place in varying states of times where I was here. We were actually here in this year of 2010, and you're gonna see photos from that time period. But you can constantly go back in time, and then you see things that don't even seem recognizable to me in the Vulture City that I know. You know, other photos taken of, it's 2013, so I don't know what year they started to restore this. Clearly even as late as 2017, the assay office looks like it was even in a worse state than what we saw, perhaps. Like, you could see the roof was caving in. So keep these images in your mind, folks, as we tour today. All right, we're gonna head all the way back to 1863 when Henry Wickenburg found really high grade ore in this particular area, and that sparked the whole interest here in what became Vulture Mine and Vulture City. Vulture Mine and Vulture City is very important to Arizona history. At one point they had as many as 5,000 people living in this area, and I've seen old photos. This place was covered with homes, and there's very little left today, but make no mistake, I would even argue that this place is responsible for the development of Phoenix, Arizona. If it wasn't for Wickenburg in this area, I don't know what would have happened. Now, I rightly couldn't tell you where the original mine shaft was, but over here is something known as the Nickel Rays, named after someone probably named Nickel. My understanding of raises are there's tunnels underneath here, and eventually they'll dig a vertical shaft that comes up to the surface from down in the depths to probably assist with getting material out in a more efficient way. So that's what this is a really deep pit, and you can see down it. Actually, you watched videos of like the more hardcore mining explorers or mine explorers that got permission to go down in this thing, and they found ore carts and all sorts of cool stuff. And if you can see down here, I'm not gonna be rock tossing today because I don't think they'd appreciate that, but you could see lights. And I wish we could see better now. I so wish I could show you or figure out a way to get a better photo. But yeah, it's just really cool the way they did this. And they've got lights going down, so you can really appreciate the depth. And here's actually a map, it looks like, of the tunnel system underneath our feet. 20 miles of mines. And we're actually right here on that raise. Now, I couldn't tell you. Some of this stuff now might be the stuff being mined out there. So who knows if they've dug down to those levels and if the tunnels all still exist today. But certainly beneath our feet here, there are some. And then, yeah, this eyesore. They don't do it like they used to. Now it's an open pit operation where they're just shaving off the top. And boy, you can really see back this way how much they've dug down in there. It's just a big gaping crater now. Wow. I can tell you the Vulture City of 2010 did not come with donkeys and horses. This is fantastic. They're just nibbling on their hay over here. So back in 2010, yeah, this whole general area was very overgrown. A lot of warnings to watch out for rattlesnakes. A lot of just metal and wood laying about everywhere down here. And I think this structure here, the cookhouse, was standing or mostly standing back in the day, and we'll get back to that. But yeah, some of this other stuff here was not in such a good state back then. Certainly, for sure, this back here, which is gonna be our starting point for really getting into this, I was not standing back in the day, I can assure you of that. So let's maybe go back now to the mind of Henry Wickenburg in 1863, roaming about this region of Arizona. This was not known to be a very friendly place back then, by any stretch of the imagination. There are still hostilities in the area with the natives that lived here, the Yavapai and probably Apache. And I saw like a photo of what was supposed to be Henry Wickenburg's very first cabin in this region. I don't know the actual location, but there was a foundation and he had dug tunnels in the back of the cabin. So imagine something probably smaller than this, where he could like hide underground if there were Indian raids. This cabin here is said to be Wickenburg's actual cabin here on the premises, probably from the earlier days of Vulture City. But yeah, this back in 2010 was a much different story. One of the fantastic aspects of this, and I didn't know this until recently, I noted they had these curious holes in the side of this cabin here with cans, like iron cans lining that. You got a couple, you know, spaced out here. And I recently read what that's all about. So going back to that worry of being invaded by
natives of the area, or even maybe bandits looking to steal your gold. Henry Wickenburg apparently built this structure with these holes in them so he could poke his rifle or his gun through to defend himself, which is really smart because I don't think anybody's going to be shooting through that foundation like that, but he certainly would have a lot of range and able to shoot somebody from the side, no problem.
It's kind of fascinating to think, you know, if this really was Mr. Wickenburg's cabin, it's actually a lot more spacious on the inside than it looks on the outside. And yeah, if you're looking at 2010 photos, this was a pile of rubble. This was not like this at all.
And that hanging tree, that ironwood out front, was a lot more unkempt back then. In fact, you could see there's a branch that I assume grew into the thing at some point and probably knocked, was partially responsible for knocking this down. So back then, yeah, this was just a pile of rubble a little over a decade ago.
And I always like this photo. This is one on the wall showing the state of the cabin in 1950. So compare this one to 2010's photo, and even this is in a much greater state. Really showing, I guess, if they wanted to rebuild this, this would have been a great guide, you know, a very handy photo to have. And I wonder, you know, how much wood were they able to repurpose from the actual site to rebuild this? I think I heard the stones certainly were, and that would make sense. Those were probably the most recoverable bits that they had in here. And I've also heard that some of these structures here that have stones are made of a high-grade ore. So who knows what some of these structures are worth in their weight in gold, quite literally. But yeah, you see it laid out here. It's not bad at all. Like, you could live a cozy life in here. I just would be worried about scorpions and other critters crawling in through these wide gaping holes here. So there's also a story about this to tell. Now, this tree is probably 200-300 years old, I've read. These ironwoods, when they get this big, that's about the age there would be. So this tree is potentially, it's seen all of the history at Wickenburg, so it knows truths that we probably will never know. We could also see it. This is what I was talking about. It, you know, pretty much grew right through the structure at some point. I do recall the 2010 version of this tree to not be as well manicured, a little bit more gnarly than it is, but in general, I mean, it's just a gnarly looking tree, like very scary, one that could be in a horror movie. Remember that tree from Poltergeist? That's the kind of vibes this gives me. And just as the sign says here, legend would have it that 18 men were hung here for high grading ore, or stealing gold ore. I think that's pretty much the same thing. So yeah. And while I can't find a single record of an actual documented hanging here, and I think that's a pretty well-known thing, it's thought that this happened regardless because it was a time of vigilantism. People would just take care of their own problems. Of course, if you know something, or if you know of a document, an old newspaper article, or something that could be traced to this, do comment down below and let us know, because I would love to see something. So going back now to 2010, I have a photo looking at approximately the same angle of this structure here. And this whole side was collapsed in. And I think the only part you could go in was the left side, which is a historic boarding house or brothel. So yeah, this is one of those things like the Wickenburg cabin that made an amazing recovery, and they did a fantastic job. Yeah, here's an old photo of what I remember, not saying because I'm old and it's black and white, but like I was saying, this is the brothel section, and then this would have been this doctor's office that we're going to peek our heads into. So even back then, I don't think I could have walked in there. Probably got some photos though, and here's a view of that same thing from the other corner, the one that was up. We'll first poke our heads into this doctor's office. And once again, I don't know how they know it was an actual doctor's office, but that is the claim. And I don't know if this is really exactly what you could have expected. I imagine they would have had a bed, but a lot of these things are relics that were probably brought in later, but you could see some implements to do some frightful operating on someone, and even the human skeleton, and all sorts of tinctures and cures. Probably some cocaine-based products in here too. And as we come over this way, now we're gonna peek into the Den of Iniquity, presumably one of the rooms where prostitutes would have worked here in this town in the 1800s or the into the 1900s. And you can really see the masonry on the wall, you know, is partially there exposing that adobe brick. It's a really fantastic look, aesthetically pleasing. And one new addition that I see a lot around here, and I would even say back as far back as 2019, I don't recall they barricaded off a lot of these things. So a lot of these rooms you can't really full on go into anymore. And in the 2010 state, I couldn't tell you if this room was accessible back then or not. Certainly that wall probably was at the very least, but one cool thing is we can go in on this side. So there are some that you can still go in. And once again, of course, this is one that has been reported to be a haunted room right here. Let's go into the brothel proper and see if we can make contact today. Not really. Oh, see, every time, I know this is in there, and every time it frightens me. You can really see evidence of the days of old here. Just look at all that discoloration on this wood panel wall. And every time I come in here, it feels more homey. Certainly back in the day, the walls were a lot more barren than what you see today. I don't even remember all of this furniture being in here, but I somehow do recall creepy dolls every time I visited here. But certainly in 2019, the same exact one. Still here. I can tell you in 2019, this area was not barricaded off. You could go full on in through the back door. But yeah, this is one of the rooms where we would assume that the ladies practiced their trade. And one of the rooms where we surmised about one of these spirits that still calls this place home, they say. There's a spirit of one of the prostitutes that would have worked here named Mexican Rita. It's the name that I've heard. Once again, very likely a legend. I don't know if there's anything tracing back to anything official, but anyway, yeah, this probably would have been a very busy place in a town like this where there's a lot of miners. Need to blow off their steam at the end of the day somehow, so this was not uncommon in towns around the turn of the century by any stretch. Okay, so this was part boarding house also. So there would have been a kitchen, that would make sense. So really small residence, though, only a couple beds, so I don't think they could accommodate volume in here. Must not have been about quantity so much as quality. And as I mentioned back in 2019, you could walk clean through this place and come out this side, which is now closed, and there was this bathtub placed out here. Not sure if this was in its original placement, couldn't tell you, but I can tell you it's been out here and they've been adding to it over time. Maybe a brief interlude from all of the Old West history and mining history to see these jolly displays that are still here, actually, long after Halloween. There's a quick story that I'll tell you about this stuff that's part of now Vulture City's history, more modern history, but it's in the books. This is the work of Ray Villafane, a very famous, well-known pumpkin carver for really outrageous, amazing looking sculptures and pumpkins. I mean, the guy's talent is through the roof. He's been on network television, and every year, going back a few years in the town of Carefree, Arizona, they would do these displays where they would intermingle the actual carved pumpkins with some of these displays. And this was here for this year's Halloween celebration, the first time they did that out here in Vulture City.
Amy and I came out here this year actually to come see it, but we decided to make it a date night. And I know we put a lot of photos on Instagram, and we'll probably show some as I talk through this now, but absolutely fantastic place to do this because it's so, like, just the art itself is so interesting and different and humorous and amazing. And then to intermingle that style of art here in this old mining town, it really pairs really well. Perfect. So I hope they leave the Halloween stuff up all year long if they can. Each scene, like the pumpkin hoedown, they just have so many stories to tell. You got, you know, all these guys with their red solo cups out here having a good old time. And then, you know, I don't know what this is all about, but this guy had too much to drink, and maybe his girlfriend or wife is taking their little baby pumpkin and dragging his butt home for a butt whooping. But yeah, just so expressive and so detailed. Some other very delightful displays here. You got a feral pumpkin over there. And you got a skeleton trying to make a run for it. And you got old Christmas guy in here, Christmas skeleton. And then back there, you just see piles of tailings and waste rock, I assume from the modern mining operation, because back in the day, I think the trail kept going out this way, and there was a hill not too far out where there was an incline shaft where I think that headframe was moved, the one we saw earlier from, and there was a powerhouse and a mill and a bunch of stuff that's now on the land of the modern operation, and some of it's been relocated here. But yeah, back in the day, you could keep walking back there as part of the tour. I want to say in one of my old photos, this was one of the approximate angles that I recall, and there was some wall collapse happening. I kind of remember this porch from a photo, so hopefully I'm referring to the correct ones. But we can poke our heads in here, I think, in this miner's boarding house or bunkhouse, and they do have this one closed off. You can poke your head in here, of course, and just very quiet. Eerily quiet in these rooms. Interesting how close in proximity the bunkhouse is to the brothel, but it looks like we can actually go in this side here. This is a little bit more cleared out. I think they use this for different things at different times, if I remember correctly. Yeah, really old structure. And just really cool things on display all around here. And you can see, if you can see out the window, yeah, there you go. There's your brothel right there. Well, I mean, these are certainly old buildings too that fit the mark for what we've been seeing. I just wonder, can we poke our head in to Villafane's workshop? I wonder what's inside of that. It's all wrapped up nice. Let's poke our heads in here and see if there's anything cool to see. It's dark in here. Very dark in here. I think they have rearranged things since Halloween. I don't even know if this was open then. Very creaky though, and scary, and you got that old wall, the adobe with that masonry on the front of it. Lots of old tools and things from the period. So this must have been the actual workshop proper if we're talking about history here. This would make sense. And you got a coffin to boot. Intermingle, that's why this place is so awesome. You can actually see one of the preserved carvings behind that glass there. And you've got an old safe here, and I want to presume that might be a bust of Henry Wickenburg made out of clay. That'd be my best guess. And yeah, you can see here's like probably closer to the time when I was out here with Amy, 2008. I don't know if this is this structure. And then older photos once again of the old
more wooden days of Vulture City.
Yeah, this is a great display to see photos from back in the day. I mean, look how many structures were actually out here dotting the landscape and how few remain today. You can see way back then, like, you know, some of the evidence of a time that's now unrecognizable. Here's the stuff left over from Halloween. I know that they redid this for Christmas, so there's really neat stuff in here, but clearly I don't think it's open right now. So, but we'll at least get a shot of this guy and show you some of our stuff. Actually, maybe you can go in. It's just very dimly lit and freaky. My camera, as always, makes this look so much more well lit, and I bet Amy regrets not coming here now to get some cool photos in this really interesting light. Look at that. There's a banner up there, Villa Fane Studios. See, I wasn't lying to you guys. What a treat that was, to be honest with you, to actually get to see the works of Ray Villafane again up close in a very dark, dimly lit setting, and all by myself without folks hovering around. I mean, that was amazing. It's worth the price of admission almost just for the workshop, to be honest. And it just doesn't stop there. I mean, even on the outside, there's very humorous, whimsical stuff all around to be found here. Okay, so on our tour, there's a couple things that I really wanna go take a peek at. We're gonna peek into the kitchen and the bar, which was a building that was mostly standing, I wanna say, where you got a lot of good photos of canned goods and old bottles and stuff that people used to put in there. And then one of the crown jewels of this place, the assay office, an 1800s original building right over there. And then we're gonna make our way back to the front where I'm gonna tell you a sad story. So they have repurposed this in modern times where they sometimes have food trucks and alcohol, beer, things you can buy here in the front, and they've got seating now. But if you come to the back of this, you can actually poke in and see a lot of historical stuff, just like we've been seeing. And I swear to God, every time I come in here, it feels like they've added more and more. It's beautiful though. I love all this old antique stuff all throughout here in this setting. It's amazing. Old furniture and maps and all sorts of really cool stuff. This is more indicative of what I would expect. And maybe it was, maybe that was like the quarters of the head chef or something like that. But yeah, even today, they've retained a lot of these original cans and things that were here way back in 2010. Got plenty of photos, or Amy especially got plenty of photos of all of this stuff. And just all sorts of old stuff. Like I've been saying this whole time, it's all over the place. And they ask you don't touch, so I've been respecting that on our journey today. And I want to say this was here. Maybe this was the collapsed in portion of this that I somehow remember in my head, but I imagine this is where the miners and folks would have eaten after a day of work. Maybe breakfast, who knows, in this general area. I mean, you can definitely see. Looks like old wood. It smells like old wood. One of my personal favorite buildings that we've seen at varying states throughout time, the old assay office. The entrance is actually on the other side there, but I wanted to start here because when we came back here in 2010, just like, you know, Wickenburg cabin was pretty much a pile of rubble, this was well on its way to becoming that. They wouldn't even allow you access back then, and while a lot of it was still standing, this entire corner here that you see here was just caved in and just rubble spilling out. And we've seen other pictures of the roof caving in varying spots. So yeah, this was not the place it is now. They really did a fantastic job cleaning this up. This is another building that I've read the actual stone that they sourced from that was from this area, and they believe it's also really high grade, containing a lot of gold. So I've heard stories that if they disassembled all of this, I mean, that could be worth a pretty penny, worth its weight in gold, quite literally.
So assay offices were things that you find a lot of, where they would have to test the ore and just test to see, like, you know, how many parts per the ore they were pulling up contained the material they were trying to mine to value, basically. But they also had storage here where they would store some of the ore for transport to other locations in a secure way, where they actually had armed guards that would stay in this place. And they had people that apparently tried to raid it a couple times throughout history.
And there are three different sections to this here. But yeah, just, you know, looking around and you just see old things that you would think are from here back in the day, back in the time. And yeah, just keep in mind, you know, back in just a couple years ago, you could roam in here as freely as you wanted to, and, you know, go up and look at the walls. You can really see, you know, these things crumble with time. And I mean, it literally is like dirt. You could, you know, pluck it away with your fingernail. So they're doing a good thing by protecting this, I would say, and limiting our access, you know, so people in future generations can enjoy this increasingly disappearing part of our history. So this is a room that I hear associated with hauntings and things like that, because they apparently stored their bullion down here in this thing. And I don't know if there's murder associated with this, certainly attempted robberies, they say, but heard stories about this room. Never experienced anything myself, though. I always found this to be kind of a humorous gesture here, being that this is haunted. A little Ghostbusters symbol welded to this door. Beautiful old looking windows, and this whole thing is one of my favorite historic structures of the Old West of all time, I must say. Especially with Ray Villafane's amazing work here. I mean, how can you not like what they've done with the place, to be honest? I mean, this is a new display, I think, for their holiday season offerings here at Villafane Studios, but so creative. And this is one of many rusted out bits that you find on the property here. I want to say back in the day, I almost recall getting a picture of this thing. It was, I don't know if it was located here or somewhere out in the back of the property in some overgrown desert, but one of the things they've certainly restored and brought to prominence out here. All right, so off in the distance over there, you see a really large metal building. That would be the powerhouse, and that was not located on this property here, the property proper, back in 2019, certainly not in 2010, although it wasn't far away. Once again, it was out past beyond the center of town on a hill out beyond.
So the reason why I wanted to save this particular building for last is it's the only one that's reported or used to be haunted that's tied to an actual death that really happened here at Vulture City back, I want to say, in the 1920s.
Before I say something incorrect, I can't claim that the gentleman died in this actual building, although it's highly possible. I think it said he died in a mill, and this is the powerhouse, not the mill. Although there used to be a mill, another building, right next to this one.
So this building, the powerhouse, housed some really hardcore equipment, pulley systems that would pull ore and probably ore carts in and out of the mine. There used to be an incline shaft on that other side that you could actually see down into the mine. They used to have a fence over it so you couldn't get inside of it. But this is where this thing used to be located. And this guy here, specifically, this old diesel engine, I want to say, from Germany, from the very early 1900s. I forget my exact dates. But this was mounted, used to have like a ladder and like this thing wrapping around it. But we saw this back in 2010 in its original setting.
And I'm so glad they recovered this, because this was on the property that the new mine operation owns. So they tore down all of the old structures. I think that's all gone. And somehow they got a deal to at least remove this powerhouse, which was not all the stuff that was over there. Like I said, there was a mill, and I don't think this is considered the mill, and some other buildings over there. But I'm so glad they at least got this one, because this was the highlight even back then.
And this is the building, if I recall, if you watched the like Ghost Adventures and shows like that, I want to say even one of the old owners claimed to have really eerie experiences hearing voices and things like that in the powerhouse, which makes one think, is that where the death occurred that I'm about to tell you about? Okay, so I got my date wrong. I was saying 1920s. It's actually 1916 is the year we need to put our heads into. So around the time of World War I. There was a young boy, we'll say young man, 19 years old, almost 20 years old, worked here at Vulture City Mine and worked around some of this heavy equipment that you can already see about you, these like systems with pulleys and belts and, you know, equipment like this.
His name was Jimmy Davis, and you know, you can even see a picture of the young guy. Want to call him a young man, but you know, 19 years old going on 20, many would consider you still a boy. Probably not back then, though. You were a man by the time you were 19, for sure.
Well, the reports go, and you can read about it, that on one of these systems, I think a belt came loose or something of that nature, and young Jimmy climbed on top of the machine to either get the belt back on or something of that nature, and something engaged, and his arm got caught in a belt or something and wrapped around it, and then he was pretty much just like flung. They said he broke every bone in his body, just torn up in some machinery, and did not even die immediately. I think he died hours later, but that must have been absolute misery. Just imagine how many broken bones and something like that, you know, that wasn't protected. Safety wasn't really a consideration back then as it is today. Well, like I said, this is one that you can verify. You can see the death certificate. You can actually visit his grave today in Wickenburg Cemetery. He's actually got a headstone there, which we're not gonna have time to seek out on this particular episode, something that I wanna go visit one day, but a real verifiable death, a violent death that one would think could spark a haunting.
That's amazing, seeing this thing. Even after a decade, to see it again, and to, it made an impression on me that long ago, and I remember just how it looked back then, except save for the little ladder and like platform that went around this thing that's no longer there.
Well, folks, there you have it. Vulture City, documented for the ages. Hope you had as much fun as I did, and I'll see you next time. Adios.